It's before eight. My goodness me, many of you are pent up frustration, want to talk about travel, but let's get the detail for our conversation because the headlines and the speculation tells us the Global Travel Task Force will announce today quarantine removed from a small number of green list countries, possibly as of May 17. We need a man with all the answers. Let's turn to Transport Secretary Grant Shapps, who joins me now. OK, Secretary of State, good morning to you. Morning, OK, man. Give us the details, if you would. People are packing, even as we speak.
I hear from what you're saying, your listeners are straining at the leash, but they don't have a list of countries.
As the Prime Minister says, that it's a pent up, that it's a cork in a bottle. When can we get on those aircraft?
I would hate to disappoint, but we don't actually have the list of countries. We need those nearer the 17th of May, which is the earliest date international travel can start to get going again, according to that Prime Minister roadmap. What we do have today is the traffic light system confirmed with some extra details. So we've got a red list, which are places from which you essentially can't come without government hotel quarantine. You've got the amber list, where you'd still have to quarantine at home. And then you've got the green list, and I think that's the one that people will be interested in, where there'll be no quarantine. You will still need to take a test before you depart to come home, and a test at home, but you won't need to quarantine. And in addition, to try to help with that, we're going to have a green watch list this year. Now, that means that we'll be letting people know where we have a country which may be coming onto the horizon of as a concern, but remain in the green list for the moment. That will help provide people a bit of forward guidance. I hope to avoid some of the scenes we saw last year where suddenly the country moves. We can't rule that out. Sometimes that might need to happen. But in general, at least we ought to be able to provide a bit of guidance.
When will the countries around the globe be put in their designated traffic light zone, Secretary of State?
They will be categorised in early May. Once the Joint Biosecurity Centre have had a look at all the countries.
I'm going to push you a little bit on that, Mr. Shapps, because early May, if we're talking about May 17, you might be able to travel. That doesn't give folk a lot of time. When you say early May, May 1, 2, 3, do you have an idea when?
I can't give you the exact date, no. And you're right, it doesn't provide loads of time. I think primarily people are probably looking towards the summer season in July and in August here. But they'll be looking at four different categories. What's the level of coronavirus in the destination country? What's the variant of concern in those countries? What are their level of vaccination? And how much are they on top of their data? Do they do sequencing domestically? Do they know what's going on? Because as I think you and I discussed before, the UK does half of the world's entire genome sequencing for the coronavirus. Most people, without that, you don't know about variants of concern. We're interested that they're doing enough of it themselves. So those are the factors they'll look at. They'll then categorise red, amber, green. Of course, we know at the moment that there's a third wave going on in many countries. So I think it's in everyone's interest to wait till a bit closer to the time to see which category each of the countries would fall into.
Secretary of State, how do you answer the charge? This is the Conservative government looking after the rich, because if you have a family of four and the children are 11 or above, you know the figures, you're looking at around £480. That's a lot of money to a family that possibly have struggled through COVID. Why? How do you justify that, Secretary of State?
I think the first thing to say is, whatever we do this summer, if we're going to say we've been through a whole year of lockdowns on and off, we've gone through the whole vaccination programme, which has been magnificent, with people coming forward and over 60% of adults vaccinated. We do not want to throw that all away. And so there's an abundance of caution in this, which is why, yes, of course, it involves still things like needing to carry out testing and some quarantine and all the rest of it. But I am very, very mindful of the costs, and here's what I'm going to do. First of all, that pre-departure test that people are having to buy and get themselves tested before they return to the UK, I'm looking at whether, for example, people could bring their own tests with them, so a bring-a-bottle version of the testing. People are now, from today, able to get two lateral flow tests a week and use those at home. Everybody is entitled to those now. So could you take that lateral flow test away with you, test yourself before you come home? That's something that we're looking at. Secondly, that test when you come home, I agree with you, they're too expensive. They're provided by private providers, and we're going to be having a very close look this next few weeks at why the costs are not being driven down, and perhaps even look at removing some who only seem to be offering very high cost PCR test, the gold standard.
Sorry, when you say removing them, what do you mean by removing them, Secretary of State?
So at the moment we have a situation where there are a whole list of private providers, and you can find them on gov.uk.
I see.
Now, you know, you'll see a massive range. The last time I looked, they range from about 65 quid up to a couple of £100 per test. Of course, the quality of the test, that must be the gold standard. That's understood.
Right.
But why is there such a range? And why has that cost not come down? Do we need more providers to create more competition? So that's something I'm going to be working with the travel industry, with the private testing providers, this next 2 or 3 weeks, to drive that test down. So we can try and make this as cheap and convenient as possible.
But here's the thing, explain to my listeners, I don't personally, but they might have had both doses of their vaccination.
Yes.
They're coming back from a green light country, that is to say one the government deems to be the most minimal risk, and they need a PCR, but fortunately he's no longer. If to go and see granddad, I can just get a lateral flow test to get into a care home.
Yeah.
Why can I get away with a lateral flow to visit a care home, but I need a PCR to come back from a green light country?
It's a great question.
Well, I'm grateful you say that. That's what I'm put on earth to do. And as Transport Secretary, you're put on earth to answer it.
Stick with it. The answer is our biggest concern are variants of concern. And what we don't know, even with two vaccinations yet, though we might do later in this summer, is the extent to which you might still be a carrier for a variant of concern, even though you are yourself somewhat or entirely protected. Nearly entirely protected. So that is our concern. Now, we're looking to the scientists to answer this, and I've put in place 3 checkpoints in this whole system. So 28th of June, 1st of July, and then June, July, and October. 28th of June, the end of July, and the 1st of October, in order to check that what we've got in place is still scientifically appropriate. So that's the point. We're going to make sure that we can answer your question. Do you still need to have a test if you are vaccinated?
But in October, Secretary of State, that's a long ways off, October, isn't it?
Oh, the October one is, but you've got the June one first. And that means that we'll be able to have an early look at this and decide whether or not we need to stick with what we've got. So we've got 28th of June, 31st of July, 1st of October. Okay. And on those dates, we'll be looking at the system itself.
So you and your colleagues, quite rightly, protecting the health of this country, people coming home. Yet you'll be aware, earlier this week, we learned on average 8,000 people from overseas arrive in this country. In some instances, a gentleman from Peru being allowed in because he said he wanted to see Big Ben. So we're very tough on Brits trying to travel. Indeed, I get a £5,000 fine if I'm trying to travel illegally. But someone comes in to see Big Ben. You sure you got your priorities right, Mr. Sherps?
Well, people right now, of course, as you rightly say, shouldn't be travelling at all. And the reason that we know about...
But we let a bloke in to see Big Ben.
Well, the reason we even know about those things is because we have the passenger locator form and we're able to explain the situation, which is you see Big Ben, but you're going to have to quarantine before you're able to see Big Ben. And what address are you going to be staying at? And by the way, we'll probably send someone around to that location to check on you. And in 10 days' time, you can go and see Big Ben. So we've never said people can't travel at all. I'll tell you what, Nick, the figure which really is really enlightening, because we've been talking about this as if it's lots of people taking summer holidays, is over a third of people in this country, over 50% in London, of children in this country are born to parents where at least one of those parents was themselves born abroad.
Sure.
And that means families are spread across the world when they live in the United Kingdom, probably more internationalist than any other country in the world, certainly any other major...
Certainly in Europe, I would argue, possibly the US, but in Europe, I think you'd probably be right, absolutely.
Well, so any other major economy. I'm not sure about the US, because half of Americans don't have passports.
Yeah, so they don't travel.
We all talk about getting to see people and being reunited as we go through these unlock stages, the next one being on Monday in the UK. But what about people being able to see their families abroad? And I want to try and help people reunite with their families. And that's why this traffic light system, giving people a framework, I think is so important.
Couple of last things. The headline in one of the newspapers today, you and I have spoken about these before, 81% of motorists don't feel safe on smart motorways, according to research done by IAM RoadSmart, formerly the Institute of Advanced Motorists. You still sticking to them, Mr. Shapps?
Yeah, I am an advanced motorist. I took their test once many, many, many years ago.
And you passed, clearly.
I did.
So you're a pilot, you're an advanced motorist, so you'll be a sea captain next, but on you go.
I don't think I'll be adding it to my CV. I'm very concerned about road safety, but I'm concerned because we have over 1,700 people dying a year on our roads, although we have amongst the safest roads in the world, I think possibly the third safest in the world, something like that. 1,700 deaths is 1,700 too much, too many, including those who die on smart motorways. I do have a dilemma. As you know, when I came in as Secretary of State, I set up a stock take immediately because I had my own concerns about these roads. And the facts of the smart motorway are a little bit more complex because, in fact, per 100 million miles driven, fewer people die overall on those roads. So I've asked the Office for Rail and Road, that's a regulator, an independent regulator, to do a further analysis of the figures so we can all get to the bottom, because we hear lots of claims and counterclaims. But I've also forced Highways England to go through a series of 18 different things to improve the safety on those roads, including stop vehicle detection radar, including many more stopping places, rescue areas, and many, many other features as well. And that work's ongoing. I just made a statement to Parliament a couple of weeks ago about it. I'll be saying more in the next few weeks.
Final question. We're looking forward to Monday, the next step as part of lockdown in England. What's going to be first for you? Nail salon, going to the pub, hairdressers, or work out at the gym? Grant Shapps.
Well, I already have a Tuesday, a barber's appointment booked. So that's early, but that's Tuesday. I think it has to be a pint outside at the pub.
All right. Thank you for your time. Have a safe weekend. Grant Shapps appearing here on LBC, where the time is 8:02. News is next.
On your radio, on Global Player, and...
Play LBC.
Leading Britain's conversation, this is LBC.
From Global's newsroom at 8:00, the government has confirmed further details of its planned traffic light system to allow